Welcome to Hindu Analysis, October 2nd, 2018, and happy Gandhi Jayanti to all. So today we are going to see all these articles. So the first article is Create an Equal and Free Society. It is stated by Justice Gogoi. So what the news here is, during the farewell speech yesterday, the Chief Justice Deepak Mishra stated that Indian judiciary is the most robust system in the world. And we all knew that Chief Justice of India, Deepak Mishra, is going to retire today. So on that farewell speech event, Justice Gogoi, who is going to swan in as the 46th Chief Justice of India on tomorrow, that is on October 3rd. He, after praising the achievements which was made by Chief Justice Deepak Mishra, he stated the importance of the constitutional values and all. That means he asked for the creation of a community which is unified in the values of equality, liberty and dignity which is enshrined in the constitution. And though there are existing a huge diversity of thoughts and opinions in our country, we are a diverse country, right? So we are divided perhaps more than ever by the class, caste, religion, ideology and gender, etc., especially today, that is even more before. So now only our society is divided on the basis of class, caste, religion, etc., on a wider basis and in a huge level than before. And stating this, he stated that the constitutional text, it already had ready-made answers, and we can construct the answers suitable to our times. That is, in one judgment they stated like fundamental rights or like the empty vessels, and the each and every generation has to fill its own wisdom in that empty vessel. So following in that line, Chief Justice Deepak Mishra is also filling his wisdom in the recent judgments like Sabarimala case, Section 377 and adultery case, etc., right? So by means of giving all those verdicts, Deepak Mishra actually enshrined the freedom to choose and the freedom of an individual and the freedom of the women's right. So these are some of the milestone verdicts which is put forward by Deepak Mishra during his period. That is like laws against mob lynching, Section 377 entirely scrapped, and ban on the entry of women is also scrapped, and other constitutionality validity and adultery is no longer a crime. So these are some of the milestone verdicts which was put forward by Deepak Mishra during his period. Okay. So the next article is BCCI comes under RTI Act. So BCCI, which is the Board of Control for Cricket in India, it is now coming under the ambit of RTI Act so that it is answerable to the people of the country. It is stated by Chief Information Commissioner. So before and all, if you want to know any information regarding this BCCI, you can't apply anything in RTI regarding the information of BCCI, but now you can do it because it is now coming under the ambit of RTI. So what is the background for this event is, an RTI applicant, she sure to know that the provisions and the guidelines under which BCCI has been representing India and selecting the players for the national team. That is, she filed an application under RTI seeking the information regarding BCCI. So these are the questions which is put forward by her. So the first one is, what is the provision and the guidelines and under BCCI for selecting the members or the players for BCCI? And whether the players selected by the BCCI are playing for India or for the BCCI association? And similarly, how a private body represent the country internationally, and how the government is benefiting by giving this right and authority to BCCI to represent the country in international arena. So these are all the questions which was put forward by that RTI applicant. So for that, the Ministry of Youth Affairs and Sports replied that there is no information available regarding the BCCI and plea could not be transferred to BCCI as the BCCI has not been declared as a public authority. As BCCI is not a public authority, we can't provide you the information. This is what the Ministry of Youth and Youth Affairs and Sports replied to that particular RTI applicant. And for that, recently the Chief Information Commissioner stated that the status, nature and the functional characteristic of the BCCI fulfill the required conditions of Section 2H of the RTI Act. So what is the Section 2H of the RTI Act means? It defines the criteria under which a body can be declared as a public authority under OTI Act. That is, whether a body is a public authority or not, it is defined, that criteria is defined under this section 2H of the OTI Act. So according to that criteria, BCI matches with that criteria. So now it is, that is, the BCCI is a public authority. So it is coming under the public scrutiny. This is what Chief Information Commissioner stated. So also the commissioner upheld the say which is put forward by the Supreme Court that BCCI is the approved national level body. But if you see, the BCCI is virtually the monopoly now. So it is having the monopoly rights to organize the entire cricket events in our country. So regarding that monopoly which is captured by the BCCI only, the Chief Information Commissioner stated that it is now coming under the ambit of the public authority. So BCCI should be listed as a national sports federation. And also the Information Commissioner sought to the Ministry of Youth Affairs and Sports to tell the or to reply to the appellant the point-wise information, whatever she asked. So he also added that state funding is one of the major element in determining whether a body is a public authority or not. If the government provides funding to that body, then it is a public authority. If it is not, then it is not. But now we have to see in more broader and contemporary perspective that how the particular body is impacting the economic and the human rights, and based on that only we are coming to the conclusion that BCCI is a public authority. So this is what stated by the Chief Information Commissioner. The next article is Gir sees 21 lion deaths in 19 days. So 21 lions have died in Gujarat's Gir forest during the September 12 to September 25. So this is a major concern because the Gujarat's Gir forest, it is the only abode of Asiatic lions in the world. That is, it is the only residence of the Asiatic lions in the world. But the place where it is having its major presence, it is under threat now, right? So what are the reasons? While they're doing some kind of research into that, they found that the infighting, injuries due to infighting, fighting and the respiratory and hepatic failure are the major causes of the death for the lions. That is, there is some kind of virus attack that is prevalent in that area. Because of that only, the lions are dying. This is what stated by the research results. Okay. So they also added that the viruses which were found or the traces of the protozoans, they are spread by ticks found in the body of the lions, which were found in 6 dead samples of the lion. And they also insisted that this kind of infection is generally limited to the lions of Samardhi forest only, but now it started spreading. So as a precautionary measure and in order to rescue the lions, all those lions are now kept in isolation and action is being taken to insulate those lions from the diseases further spreading and for the prevention of the death of the lion, that is Gir forest lions. So the next article is government put Uday Kotak in charge to stem IL and FS crisis. So what the news here is, the government has taken over the debt-ridden infrastructure leasing company, which is this IL and FS group. Okay, so now the current management has been suspended and new management under Uday Kotak takes over the management oriented aspects of that particular firm, which is the IL and FS. So after the National Company Law Tribunal moved or approached by the government for changing the management, it is now declared legally. So what the news here is, this IL and FS firm, which is having a lot of stakeholders, including State Bank of India, HDFC, LIC, and some kind of other companies like Japan Company and Abu Dhabi and Central Bank of India, etc. So these are all the stakeholders in that particular firm. So now this firm is undergoing a crisis, which is a debt crisis. Nearly 91,000 crore of debts it is now, as of now, it is having. So its asset value is like 1,15,000 crore. Okay, so it is having assets of 1,15,000, but its debt is like 91,000 crore, and it is having subsidiaries like in terms of 169 in number. Okay. So if you see this IL and FS, which kind of company it is? It is a major infrastructure financing and construction company, which is funding the major infrastructure projects in the country. And the investors who are putting their money or who are investing their money in these firms are usually private individuals, mutual funds, as well as the pension funds, etc. They are the investors. Okay, these kind of investments are made in those firms. And the shareholders include LIC and HDFC. And the biggest lender to this firm, that is, SBI is the biggest lender. SBI gives money to this IL and FS. And the IL and FS in turn gives the or funds the money for the infrastructure projects in the country. Okay, so what is the crisis now? That is, The IL&FS is now suffering from cash crunch and debt pileup. That is, it runs out of money now and has a debt of 91,000 crores and starts missing debt repayments in recent weeks. It couldn't be able to repay the loan, whatever it is getting from SBI, LIC, or whatever the firms that it is getting the money. And the stock markets in turn went into panic and shock. That is, so this non-repayment by the IL&FS is not only going to affect the subsidiaries, but it is also going to affect the entire economy itself. So it could potentially affect the savings of millions of the people in our country, as well as now, as of now, what it needs is a massive bailout by government. So, okay. So if you go deep into this issue, how the crisis actually occurs means because of the mismanagement or the misregulation which is in that particular firm. So the first one is the asset liability mismatch. Whatever asset it has to borrow that much proportion of the liability, right? But it is exceeding that. So borrowed many times the money of its equity it has. This is the first major misregulation which is done by the IL&FS. The second one is financing long-term infrastructure projects with short-term funding. It is getting the fund from SBI or LIC for short-term and it lent to the infrastructure project for long-term. Obviously, it is not going to get the return as and when possible because it is a long-term project. It is not going to return as soon as possible, but it has to pay the amount or it has to pay the return to the short-term persons, right? So this also widened the debts in the IL&FS. And the third one is turn from to finance infrastructure to special purpose vehicles, like that is before its aim is only to fund for the infrastructure projects. But now instead of funding alone, it also started doing its own infrastructure projects like wind energy, power, building gift cities for the government, road and toll projects, etc. So people who are putting money or who are investing money in this IL&FS, they believe that we are investing in a funding or financial company, but what they are actually investing is a project based or a power project based company, right? So you understand the difference. So this is also a major drawback because now it start doing its infrastructure projects on itself. So it is also having a dragging the time limit to return to the people who are investing their money. So these are all the issues. And also the management in the IL&FS is very opaque and mismanaged borrowings, that is getting more money than what it has. These are all led to the recent debt crisis in IL&FS. So what is the major drawback here is, though it is having a lot of liquidity crisis, that is, it is not at all having enough circulation of money in its normal functioning, but it is, despite of that, it is continue to pay the profits and dividends to the stakeholders and huge managerial payouts. So these are all, it should actually constrain all those things, right? But it is not doing that. So these are all lead to the loss of the total credibility of the financial sectors itself. So for all these debt pileup and crisis, now the government has committed to ensure the needed liquidity to that particular firm in order to restore the credibility back, okay? So that there is no more defaults and the infrastructure projects, whatever by means of getting the fund from this IL&FS, it is continue smoothly, okay? So if you see this, how this debt crisis is getting revealed is by means of the series of defaulting by that particular firm. That is, it started defaulted on the commercial payment repayment first in August, and then it started default on repayment of 1,000 crore deposit to SIDBI. That is, SIDBI is providing certain kind of fund to this particular firm. It is not going to repay back, so it is defaulting on that also. So these continuous or series of defaulting only made the government to take the adequate steps in order to change the management of the particular firm itself. So the assets and the receivables, whatever procured by this particular firm, is actually getting exaggerated in the financial statements itself. It is misleading. So the investigation has been ordered by the government to the Serious Fraud Investigation Office, that is SFIO. So it asked that particular office to take over or to start the investigation in that particular firm. What are the major concerns or what are the unanswered questions here is, though the RBI stated this firm as a systematically important company, though it stated like that, how over leveraging escaped the notice of the RBI? if it is an important company, then it is obviously coming under the ambit of the purview or the scrutiny of RBI. But how it escapes this much time? How it getting over leveraged? This is what the first major question. Second is, what periodic inspections of the company of RBI revealed? That is, the periodic inspections carried out by the RBI, what those data revealed? If it is not misleading, then it should have found this crisis even before itself, right? So this is also the second major concern. So the third question here is, how the developing situation of these debt crisis, that is the increase in the debt crisis, missed in the eye of the shareholders who are the part of that particular firm. So these all questions can only be answered if the new management by the government, it is going to take the adequate measures and the steps in order to properly regulate the particular firm. Okay. So it is like the continuation of that before article, that is, further defaults will not take place, it is stated by the government. So we have seen that the IL and FS company, it is a large systematically important infrastructure funding company, right? So it is declared by the RBI. And the government now, due to the pileup of the debt crisis in that firm, the government approached the NCLT, which is the National Company Law Tribunal, asking to change the management. Under which act means? Under the section 241, which it should be read with 242 of the Companies Act of 2013. So under the Companies Act, it has the supersession of present board of directors to its substitution by a new board of directors. So it is prescribed under Companies Act 2013. So stating this, the government asked to change the management, and now it changed the management. So it made its clear commitment to ensure more liquidity to the particular firm in order to recover the debt. So what are the measures that is going to be taken by the government after this management change is, maybe it will be like asset sales or restructuring of some liabilities by that particular firm, and a fresh infusion of the funds by the investors and as well as the lenders. These might possibly be the steps which will be taken by the government in the future in order to restore the credibility back to that particular firm. So the next article is, Child Abuse Helpline Gets Lewd Calls. That means the Ministry of Women and Child Development inaugurated in 2016 itself the helpline as a part of e-box initiative. So for what purpose means? To enable filing of complaints of sexual offences against the children by means of allowing the users to file a complaint online or call this particular helpline toll-free number. But what the news here is, this particular toll-free helpline number is recently getting lot of lewd or dirty calls from the people, especially from the rural and the uneducated people, because of their lack of awareness of that purpose itself. That is, they don't know what actually this number is meant for, and they started calling to that particular number and they started seeking certain kind of sexual services itself. So this is a major concern. So for that, the National Commission of Protection of Child Right forced to temporarily bore the calls to that toll-free number. So as of now, it is temporarily bore the calls, okay? So this NCPCR, it is an apex child rights body, and as a temporary measure, what they are trying to do is, hereafter you are getting some kind of recorded message information if you are calling to that particular helpline number, and in that recorded message it states that you are calling for sexual offenses against children. This is a helpline for that purpose. So it is a major move in that, in order to curb or in order to avoid such kind of lewd calls, okay? So if you see here, 53% of the children's or victims of this kind of sexual offences, it include both boys and girls, and 2/3 of the children's are getting physically abused every day, and 8 cases are reported every day. So in that, Uttar Pradesh is the first in these kind of offences, and it is followed by Delhi. So these are all the major concerns, right? So we have to tackle all these things by means of doing these kind of initiatives. So what is the way forward here is, first of all, the people should have the awareness of all these kind of initiatives, and they should spread all these kind of awareness among the people in order to curb these kind of misuse of certain good initiatives and all. So the next article is, center initiates probe or measures into type 2 poliovirus contamination. So what the news here is, during a routine environmental surveillance of collecting sewage samples from the high risk sites in Mumbai and all, they found that the P2 strain, which is a polio type 2 strain, was found in that particular sewage sample. So it raised a major concern that whether the polio has resurfaced again. That is because we already have declared, that is India have already declared as a polio free country, but now this shows that maybe that means the polio might be get resurfaced. So for that, the Union Health Ministry ordered an inquiry into type 2 poliovirus contamination, and additional immunization program should also get started in that particular areas. So first, we have to know what is this polio. So poliomyelitis, it is an highly infectious viral disease mainly affecting the children. So according to the WHO, this virus can be transmitted from person to person and mainly through the fecal and oral route. So we have to properly vaccinate the children so that in order to not getting the transmission of these kind of diseases. So there are three types of poliovirus strains, type 1, 2, 3, that is P1, P2, P3, and P2 was eradicated globally in 1999 itself, and India attained a polio-free status in 2014, okay? So if you see here, these are the schedules on which how this vaccine is administered to the children. So what the recent news is, as this P2 strain is detected in the vials used in the immunization of vaccine to the children in Uttar Pradesh, Maharashtra and Telangana, they wanted to take some kind of precautionary measure so that the polio doesn't resurface again in our country. So if you see, the last case in type 2 poliovirus was recorded in Aligarh in India, and the last case in type 1 polio was recorded in Howrah. Okay, and after that it is completely eradicated. So if you see here, India eliminated the type 2 strain in 2016 itself, and the vaccine available for that particular P2 strain is also completely phased out in that particular period. So if you see, the children whoever born after the 2016, they are having no immunity to that P2 strain. So this is a major concern, because as this new samples or the sewage samples contain P2 strain, whether it raises a question that this P2 strain, that is the P2 polio, is again started resurfacing, right? But the children are not having their immunity, so we have to take some adequate measures. We have to properly immunize those children with this P2 vaccine. That is what the government's major focus as of now. So if you see, the WHO vaccine, it is containing all the three stereotypes, that is P1, P2, P3. The trivalent preparation of vaccine is there, but in India we are only having P1 and P3, not P2. We phased out the P2 vaccine completely, so only it is a concern now. So what the relief point of view here is, the sewage sample contained only the vaccine virus and not the wild polio virus. So the government intensified the immunization rounds in those particular area wherever this P2 strain was found. Okay, the next article is, leaders will have to pay for damage by cadre. So this is stated by the Supreme Court for the mob lynching incidents which is prevailing in our country. So what the Supreme Court stated is, the leaders of the outfits who instigate a mob to an act of vandalism. So if a group is indulged in an activity of mob lynching or demolishing of any structures or killing of any persons, in that particular group, whoever the leader of that group, they are only going to get the punishment. This is what stated by the Supreme Court. And the Supreme Court also added that the leader is going to personally face the criminal action, and he is only liable to compensate the victim for their loss during that violence, and they should not do or they should not carry out mob lynching activities, especially against the cultural programs, films and expressions of the artistic freedoms. So these are all put forward by the Supreme Court in order to ensure the freedom or expression of the freedom in our country. And they also added, the taxpayer is not responsible to cough up the money to pay for the destruction caused by mobs. Mobs are causing the destruction. Why the taxpayer's monies are used to recover it back? This is also questioned by the Supreme Court. So if you see, these are all the sections under which the leaders are getting arrested if they are involved in mob lynching. That is 153 for promoting enmity, 295A, 298, 495. These are all the sections of Indian Penal Code under which they are getting arrested. And any leaders who are failed to appear in the police station after getting caught, he shall be proceeded as an suspect, and even he got declared as a absconding offender itself. This is also added by the Supreme Court. So they also asked the state governments to establish rapid response teams district-wise to respond to that mob lynching activities and install the websites and special helplines during that emergence of those kind of mob lynching activities in order to curb that at the initial level itself, and employ non-lethal crowd control devices like water bombs, etc. So the next article is at Sabarimala, walking the extra mile. So we all knew that recently Supreme Court declared that the women of all age groups can enter into the Sabarimala temple, and they should not be prohibited from entering into the temple simply on the basis of their biological reasons. And they also struck down that particular religious law, that is exclusion of women of 10 to 50 age group from Sabarimala temple itself. So this is like making the entry of women a legally recognized right now. So this has put an end to the long-raging question of gender discrimination, but this is not an end of the story. We have to do even more, that is, simply allowing the women into the temple. This is not at all enough. We have to make the environment suitable for the women entry, right? So this is what proposed by the author in this article, that is, the infrastructure in that Sabarimala temple area in Kerala, it has to be carefully revamped so that that particular place can be made as a gender-sensitive place, okay? So why what the author proposed here is, that is, if you see that particular Sabarimala, that pilgrimage place, it is the several aspects of that pilgrimage have rested on the premise that there are no women around. That is only a male dominated place, right? So it is mostly having not that much adequate facilities for women. So we have to make that environment which is suitable for women in terms of security, in terms of adequate facilities for them. So this is the first thing which is proposed by the author. The second is, the situation is set to change. That is, there should be some kind of radical transformation in the management itself to include more and more transformations in terms which is suitable for the women entry into that particular temple. So the shrine, that is this particular Sabarimala shrine, that is, it is about 5 kilometers inside the forest in the Periyar Tiger Reserve. So it is a difficult terrain and it is accessible only by foot. So these are all some kind of impediments which the women are going to face in the future if it is not getting changed. And the accommodation, it is very inadequate. So dozen buildings and a few sparsely furnished cottage, and which was built only 50 years ago, and it is not. So these kind of smaller accommodation facilities, it could only accommodate only 3,000 pilgrims at a time, which is not adequate if the women is also going to join in this crowd. And the land available with the Devasthana board of the Sabarimala temple, it is also limited. So constructing more buildings is not an option. And if you see this picture, this step, that is this steep and narrow 18 steps, it is like leading to the sanctum, and it permit only 90 persons per minute. So it cannot be hold 1.2 lakh pilgrims per day, even if it is open for entire 24 hours, but it is not the case. And in reality, it's only holding like 50,000 pilgrims per day. So these are all the concerns which is raised by the author, which needs to be addressed by the government by means of new changes or transformation in the management of the temple. Okay. So what the author suggests here is, there should be some kind of queue complexes that should be built for comfortable waiting period for both the men and the women. And the policing at Sabarimala, it should be drastically changed. It is what he stated, that is, it is more in as of the current situation, the policing is mainly focusing on the crowd control rather than the pilgrimage control. But if you get, or if you allow women into the Sabarimala temple, it is getting more wider, and it is to manage the crowd, it is need even more drastic changes in the style of policing itself. It is what the author stated here. And the accommodation policy is also needs to be framed, keeping the women entry in mind. And the toilets are segregated, and women staff should be engaged, and several gender specific requirements have to be planned and provided by the Devasthanam board as well as by the government in that particular place. And the author also stating that using the existing infrastructure itself, if you are doing meticulous planning and professional management, you can make it better. That is what he stated. And What he is raising a concern is the existing managerial and administrative ethos are only inadequate, but the infrastructure facilities and all is okay now. So you have to meticulously plan and then you have to execute. This is what he raised his concern. What is the way forward here is solutions can be found only if you admit the deficiencies and showing a willingness to embrace the unfamiliar changes. This is what stated by the author. So the last article is Up in the Air on Stubble Burning. So we all knew that the atmospheric pollution in North India, especially in Delhi, is increasing very high. But during the onset of the winter season, that is because of the harvesting of the rabi crops, the remains of the kharif crops, which was harvested before during the northwest monsoon season, right? So the remains of that kharif crops needed to be cleared in order to make space for this new rabi crops. For that, what the farmers are doing is they just burn the remains or they burn the paddy stubble to clear their field. So it is a major concern because already the atmospheric pollution is rising by means of vehicle pollution, biomass burning, firecrackers, etc. in Delhi as well as in other urban centers. So this burning of the paddy stubble by the farmers is also adding its part to the pollution. Nearly 20% of the smog is by means of this paddy stubble burning by the farmers. It is a major concern, right? To tackle this pollution issue, the Supreme Court constituted an Environment Pollution Prevention and Control Authority, and this EPCA directed the center to do some kind of adequate measures to stop this kind of burning by the farmers. So the center is partnering with Punjab, Haryana and Uttar Pradesh to provide the farmers a range of mechanized equipments to clear their fields of paddy crop residue. That is, instead of doing it like burning the residue, you can make use of the machines in order to clear the field. This is what the center aimed at. Okay, so they also provided 50% of the subsidy to the farmers, 75% of waiver to cooperative societies and agencies, whoever getting involved in providing these kind of mechanized equipments to the farmers to clear their fields. So they provide these kind of subsidies to the farmer interest group as well as the gram panchayat to buy such machines, and they rent out the equipment itself. And nearly 650 crore is given by the government to help the farmers to buy these kind of subsidized equipment. So what are those mechanized equipments means? They are happy seeder, paddy straw choppers and zero till drill. So these are the machines. If you see in this picture, these are the machines, okay, to clear the field. So farmers, particularly those with land holdings of less than 5 acres, they are remains skeptical about this kind of machine usage because they thought like it will affect the productivity of the land and it will damage the soil itself. So they are concerned, and because they are having very lesser land holding, they are hesitant to buy the mechanized equipment itself. So we have to address all these things. So just making technological tools available may not be enough. Proactive engagement of the government to both persuade as well as to reassure the farmers in engaging these usage of the mechanized equipments to clear their field should be ensured.